Hello everyone. Today, every doctor knows about HIV. We know how it's transmitted, we know what it does if left untreated. But still, thousands of HIV infections go undiagnosed for years. And all this time, the virus is gradually destroying the patient's immune system until it finally causes severe immunosuppression or AIDS. And at that point, treatment becomes much more difficult and less likely to succeed. Devastating opportunistic infections and life-threatening complications are basically unavoidable, and even if the patient survives, which is far from certain, chances are that their quality of life will never be the same. So wouldn't it be great if we were able to diagnose HIV right in the beginning, shortly after the patient gets infected? And this is the topic of today's lecture: how to recognize acute HIV infection or acute retroviral syndrome. Because with early treatment, our patients will have a much better prognosis, but not only that, it's extremely important for our patients to know that they are infected, because this early, in this acute stage, the virus is especially transmissible. The viral load is extremely high, much higher than it will be just a few weeks after that, once it reaches the chronic state. So yes, being able to diagnose acute HIV infection is an essential skill for a clinician who works in acute care or primary care. The trouble is, the symptoms of acute HIV infection can be rather unspecific. Some patients will present with such unimpressive symptoms that there is no way you will be able to tell that this is actually HIV. It will look just like another cold or a flu, right? But in most cases, you will be able to find clues that will point you in the right direction if you pay attention. Many patients will actually present with the so-called mononucleosis-like syndrome, which means their condition will kind of look like infectious mononucleosis, the kissing disease. If you work in acute care, I bet you've seen a lot of patients with infectious mononucleosis. It affects mostly school kids, teenagers, right? I guess this is why it's been dubbed mono. It sounds cooler, teen-friendly, like an app or something. The virus that causes mononucleosis, EBV, the Epstein-Barr virus, is ubiquitous, it's everywhere. And actually, most people get infected already in their childhood and they never even know about it. The ones that are unlucky enough to first get infected later in their teens or after that are more likely to end up with the typical symptoms of mononucleosis, which include prolonged fever, fatigue that can last for weeks, muscle pain, sore throat with these huge swollen tonsils with a lot of exudate, big swollen lymph nodes, especially in the neck, and when you examine your patient, you might notice an enlarged spleen or liver, and in the labs you will see elevated AST and ALT lymphocytosis with atypical lymphocytes. Atypical lymphocytes are actually T cells that get mobilized in response to this infection. So this is what your typical Epstein-Barr infectious mononucleosis looks like. So how is this mononucleosis-like syndrome caused by HIV different? Well, fever, malaise, muscle pain, sore throat, swollen lymph nodes, all of that is still here. But when you take a look at your patient's throat, in acute HIV, generally, you won't find impressive swollen tonsils with a lot of exudate like you would find in infectious mononucleosis. Instead, look for mouth sores. So, examine the oral cavity carefully, looking for these small, shallow, whitish ulcers with a surrounding halo of redness. Usually, they will be painful, so even if you don't see them, ask your patient if they feel like they have mouth sores, they will point to where they are, right? In addition to that, sometimes you might find oral thrush or candidiasis. So these two findings, mouth sores and candidiasis, are very uncommon in infectious mononucleosis, but they can be found in acute retroviral syndrome. Also, take a look at your patient's skin. Many patients with acute HIV will present with this impressive generalized maculopapular rash. It will be kind of reddish or pinkish, most pronounced on the trunk, the chest, the neck, the face. Also, take a close look at the palms and feet. If you find this generalized rash in association with the mononucleosis-like syndrome, you have to suspect acute HIV. Generalized rash is uncommon in infectious mononucleosis unless if it happens as a reaction to certain antibiotics, but this is a topic for another lecture. So once again, generalized rash plus mononucleosis-like syndrome, you have to suspect acute HIV. Another common symptom of acute HIV infection that you won't find in infectious mononucleosis is diarrhea. Many patients with acute HIV will present with gastrointestinal problems. Many can even lose an impressive amount of weight in a very short period of time. Again, this is not typical for infectious mononucleosis. And finally, in the literature, you will see that patients with HIV can present with aseptic meningitis, and that is true. Some can present with severe headache and fever. So if you have a patient with aseptic meningitis and you don't know the cause, always at least consider HIV. But this presentation is not as common as mononucleosis-like syndrome. And in the end, whenever you are trying to figure out the right diagnosis, whenever you have a patient with unexplained symptoms, ask yourself, who is my patient? Why would my patient have infectious mononucleosis? Or why would my patient have HIV? Because remember, infectious mononucleosis usually affects teenagers, school children. Most people get infected with this virus by the age of 25. So if you see, let's say, a 40-year-old with symptoms of infectious mononucleosis, it's time to stop and think. It's kind of like seeing a 40-year-old on a skateboard. I mean, it can happen, but it does stand out, right? It is unusual. So you have to think about other potential causes of mononucleosis-like syndrome, including, of course, HIV. Also, you want to know if your patient is at increased risk of infection. Unprotected sex and intravenous drug use are major risk factors. All doctors know this. Most patients are aware of this as well. But keep in mind that the incubation period is about 2 weeks on average, but it can be a lot longer than that. So many patients, even if they did engage in high-risk behavior, let's say a month ago, might not mention that because, number one, this is still a big taboo in our society, and two, they might not associate something that happened a month ago with the symptoms that they're experiencing right now. So it's up to you as a clinician to make this connection. Also remember that STDs are transmitted the same way as HIV, and STDs that create ulcers on the genital mucosa, like syphilis for example, actually facilitate the transmission of HIV, and co-infections are actually quite common. So it's quite important for you to know if your patient had an STD recently. Even if the patient is not ready to discuss this with you, when you ask them about this, at least they will realize that you as a medical professional think that it's a good idea for them to get tested for HIV. And this is already the step in the right direction. Maybe they are not ready to get tested right away. Maybe they would prefer to do it anonymously later on. Some people simply need time to process this idea. Always keep in mind that the very mention of HIV is still terrifying. So don't be surprised if many people get scared, defensive, or even downright offended when you mention testing. So please take your time and be careful with your delivery. You can't just say, you know what, that little weird sore throat of yours, I think it's HIV. No, slow down and make sure that you explain to your patient why you think it's necessary for them to get tested. In short, mononucleosis-like syndrome, or flu-like syndrome for that matter, that doesn't include impressive tonsillopharyngitis, but does include oral or genital ulcers, oral candidiasis, generalized maculopapular rash, or diarrhea with sudden weight loss, and especially if your patient engaged in high-risk behavior recently, of course, you need to suspect acute retroviral syndrome. This channel is all about recognizing serious conditions as early as possible. That is why I created a short free online course for clinicians, for people who need to make quick decisions based on limited information. If you work in acute care or primary care, I highly recommend you take this course as soon as you can. It will make a great difference in practice. Thank you for watching. Good luck out there and take care.